Welcome to HCAM News Focus. Tom Nappe at the anchor desk to keep you up to date with everything you need to know about Hopkinton. On this edition of HCAM News Focus, we will take a further look at the restoration of the Claflin Fountain and revisit all the tremendous events that occurred during the anniversary celebration weekend as Hopkinton celebrated its 300th birthday. The Claflin Fountain was originally donated by Charles L. Claflin in 1907 to honor the memory of his parents, Charles Winslow Claflin and Anne Maria Claflin. After years of being a beloved site at the town common, the fountain eventually became ran down and deteriorated. After years of planning and months of designing, sculptor Jeff Boccaccio and his team successfully restored the fountain. Lenny Holden, who was chosen as the chair of the fountain subcommittee, explained the process and gave some history about the fountain.
My name's Lenny Holden. I've lived in town all my life. I've been on Parks and Rec, I've been a selectman. Last year, the Parks and Rec Commission asked me if I'd be the chairman of the restoration committee. Since then, we've put it out for bid. We've got, we had a lot of qualified bidders. We chose Boccaccio Studios and Natick as our conservator, the one that's doing all the work. Right now, the fountain was disassembled in April. It was wheel abraded. They used steel balls to get all the rust off. We had to have two sections, a bowl and a column that were missing. The stories that it went over in the hurricane of 38. Other stories were that it was some seniors from high school, the old high school, that blew it up. But nevertheless, we've had those resculpted and recast. Everything now, you can see behind me, with it's a new foundation. It went real deep. We're never going to have it tip over on us. The other structure is the pump assembly. It's state of the art. It'll make sure it keeps enough water in there. The pieces, some are at a studio in Canton, and they were the missing pieces were cast by Wollaston Foundry, I guess it is, and right now they're being ready to be painted. It's an epoxy paint. It'll last forever. We just have to have a maintenance program yearly. You'll come out, check it over, touch up any of the bronze accoutrements, and any pits or anything like that they'll take care of. This one lasted over 100 years, and with the improvements that we've done, who knows how long it could last. It's next Tuesday, September 1st, we'll be bringing all the pieces here and start to reassemble it. There's a big bowl, then a column, then a small, medium-sized bowl, then the new column that was sculpted, and another bowl that was resculpted, and the top, and a new finial on the top. And hopefully it'll all come together and be running for the start of our celebration on September 11th.
Now, how long has this whole process taken overall?
Well, it's been years. We've been talking about it. They brought me in, I think it was last fall, and we got a committee of five. Eric Sonner from Parks and Rec, Tim Kilduff, Jeff Ferber, and Stacy Spies. And we've all been meeting. We were meeting, made a selection of who was going to do it. We've had a few meetings since then. We've worked with town departments like the Historic District Commission and the town engineer. We weren't sure about the color. We were going to wait until the last minute and just try to find something historical. But when Jeff Boccaccio took the bronze embellishments off, found the original color to be black. So we're going to keep it historic and keep the original black. And with the embellishments, the scroll work, Jeff has restored the ones that were existing, and he's cast the other ones. And I think the aged bronze will just pop out on the dark black background.
Parks and Rec, we are the kind of the managers and custodians of the common itself. So when the idea came up to restore and refurbish the fountain, we help coordinate along with the CPC committee, the trails committee, and the town engineer. Pretty much a big collaboration among multi-town departments and committees.
The fountain was here in a dilapidated state, half of it missing, and was more of an eyesore than an attraction. Part of our idea was, let's turn this fountain into what it was when it was installed in 1907 as the Kaplan Fountain, restore it to its original greatness. And quite frankly, there had been many efforts over the years to do that, but they had all fallen just short of starting and getting it going. So we pulled everything together. We hired historians and whatever to find out what it looked like. We put it out to bid and came up with a company that could do this. In fact, we had many companies bid on it that had the expertise to do it. And here we are. The thing has been restored. It's being installed today. And we feel it will be the major attraction, other than the gazebo, of our time to come.
This has sort of been like a multi-year effort of trying to get the funding and the whole project going. Years ago, we initially allocated the money to do research on it and what we thought was enough money to get the fountain done. And over the years, we found out it was going to cost a lot more. So it's been actually a couple of years in the making and getting the approved funding from CPC. We just think it's one of these things in the town where the money from historic will be put to very good use, and we're very pleased to participate in this. Getting the funding, this started almost 10 years ago with the initial funding, and the final vote on the funding was about a year ago, and the idea was to get it done in time for this celebration this year, and it looks like we are right on target.
One of the great things about the fountain being completed during the 300th anniversary year is when everything is said and done after this year ends, the only standing remembrance of the 300th anniversary will be this fountain. There'll be a time capsule, it'll be buried, and no one will see it for a century, but for all intents and purposes, this will be the lasting tribute to our 300th anniversary.
Sculptor Jeff Boccaccio explained to HCAM News the steps involved with restoring the fountain.
First off, can you talk about the process of putting together this fountain and getting it ready for installation?
Sure. So the first thing we did was we looked at historical reference, seeing that half the fountain was actually missing. So we looked at the historic photos, we took measurements, and recreated the missing components. Once the missing components were sculpted and approved by the committee, those components then went to the foundry where they were sand-casted, tap and dyed, dry fitted together to make sure that everything, once we got it on site, went together properly. So as you can see now, what we're doing is we've got the bottom basin in, and we're now starting the first center posts. We've got that section to go in next. Once that section goes in, then the first basin off the ground will go in, and then so on and so forth until we're at the top.
All right, now how long did it take to get this all together, time-wise? Months, weeks?
Months and months. So I think we pulled it apart in March of last year. Of this year, I'm sorry. So we've been working hard since then on it, and so there's the obvious unknown things that occur when you do a historic project like this. A lot of the components that we thought we could use, some of the internals, were so badly rotted and corroded and compromised that we had to actually replace them. So we ended up replacing all that stuff.
Can you talk about your career a little bit doing sculptures like this? Is this your first historical type of sculpture, or have you done things like this before?
Yeah, we do a lot of historic conservation and restoration work, be it a fountain, a memorial, stone, bronze. We do a lot of bronze restoration work. We just completed the 25-foot tall General Ambrose Burnside Monument in Providence, Rhode Island, in the Burnside Plaza. We do a lot of commission sculpture work from scratch. In other words, a client will come to us and want something like this made new, brand new. So we do that. And private commission as well. You know, it might be a portrait of someone, a marker. Right now we're working with the town of Natick. There were two gentlemen that were on the DPW that passed, and so we're doing memorial markers for them. Portrait of their face, and then some verbiage down below it. And we're also, one of the other projects we have is a Vietnam memorial for the Metro West Transit Authority. Approximately 15 foot tall Vietnam soldier holding an M16, looking like he just kind of came out of a skirmish in the jungle. So
you do a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
Is this the biggest fountain you've done, or have you done bigger fountains than this before?
This is actually the tallest fountain, yeah. So.
All right. Now talk about the process so far. It looks like, at least from what I've seen, that the base took the longest to get in. Is that the case? The rest of the pieces are a little bit, take a little bit less time?
Yeah, less complicated. So that base, it was critical that was watertight. And you can see, you probably saw yesterday, we've got 7 holes in the bottom of that basin, all that have plumbing that have to line up to it, that go to this state-of-the-art plumbing house that we've had constructed. So bringing that basin up, getting it all bolted together and have all of the caulking, if you will, in place, and then lowered down on top of that, there's a lot of things that need to all line up perfectly in order for that base to come down, seat properly, and be watertight. The other components now, as you can see Kevin over there, he's putting a riser in. Now this piece will go down on top of it. There'll be an L bracket that'll come out the side, and then we'll shoot up to the next basin, and then finally we'll go all the way up to the top for the bollard that's on the top of it. So, the rest of it should go pretty quick today.
The process of installing the restored fountain pieces took nearly 20 hours throughout 2 days. Jeff Boccaccio and his team worked long hours to get the fountain ready for the 300th anniversary celebration weekend. Here are some pictures of what was a very grueling process.
Thank you.
After the fountain was finally installed, the Hopkinton Garden Club added even more beauty to the scene, and with the help of a number of volunteers, a garden was planted around the fountain to kick off the 300th anniversary celebration weekend. On Friday, September 11th, the town gazebo was rededicated to one of the founders and main fundraiser, Ernie Fecto, and the Claflin Fountain was officially revealed.
On Friday, September 11th, Hopkinton's 300th anniversary celebration weekend began with a moment of silence, which was held to recognize the victims of the terrorist attacks just 14 years ago.
Today's obviously become a somber day in this nation's history. We experienced, I think all of us, what will hopefully be the most catastrophic national event of our lifetimes that day. But it's important to realize that that as terrible as that was, and despite the fact that we need to remember all these people, the simple fact is life does go on, and it's not disrespectful at all to celebrate tremendous events or to show joy on this day. In fact, in some ways, it's probably one of the best ways we can remember those people. As we think about what we're here to do tonight, we should remember that the fountain that we're going to turn on here again in a few minutes has only been in place for a small fraction of the town's history, yet it has seen two world wars, a pandemic, and the Great Depression. But importantly, it's also seen man walk on the moon, the end of the polio and smallpox viruses, and it's seen a small country that was on the periphery of Europe turn into the greatest power that the world has ever seen. So certainly what we learn, I think, is that there can be tremendously positive events, and despite the challenges that we may all face, there are many great things that come about here, and we need to focus on those on nights like this. Tonight is to welcome you all here in that vein, focusing on the positive. We are here to celebrate our history and what we've become, despite the challenges we faced along the way. Our town actually existed for half a century before there even was United States, and we should be thrilled at how far we've come in that time. So with that, it is my great privilege to welcome you to the start of our fantastic 300th anniversary birthday weekend. The way we'll work this tonight is that we actually have put in place a time capsule, you may not know this already, up in the gazebo. Underneath a newly laid foundation stone, we have a capsule will be opened in the next 100-year anniversary, and we'll cut the ribbon on the gazebo here in a few minutes to officially dedicate that.
And one, two, three. There we go. All right. Yay, it's open.
Former Hopkinton Board of Selectmen Chair Eric Sonnet reintroduced the misplaced plaque honoring Ernie Fecto, the main fundraiser behind the original gazebo.
In 1995, the Board of Selectmen presented Ernie with what amounted to a Lifetime Achievement Award. And it was a plaque that essentially said, thank you, thank you, thank you. We want to always remember it. Well, we remembered it until we knocked down the old gazebo to build this one, and the plaque got misplaced. So what we've done is we've recast it. We were even smart enough to make two of them in case something happens to this one. And we've put it back on the wall as a tribute to Ernie. Let me tell you something. Ernie Fecto was the best of us, and it's only fitting that we rededicate this to him. Excuse me while I pull the thing off. And Ernie would have seen the fountain the last time it ran too, which is even better. Ernie was born during World War I, served in World War II, and lived through the first Gulf War. He had seen it all, and this veterans gazebo is a tribute to not only the veterans, but the guy that made it happen.
Chairman of the Fountain Subcommittee, Len Holden, then told the history of the Claflin Fountain that was erected in the memory of Charles Winslow Claflin and Maria Claflin by their son, Charles L. Claflin, in 1907.
One of Hopkinton's most esteemed residents, he had financial interest in large coal yards ranging from Albany, New York to Boston. He was the eastern agent of the Delaware and Hudson Coal Company and president of the Massachusetts Wharf Coal Company in Boston. Locally, he was president of the Hopkinton National Bank, a trustee of the Hopkinton Savings Bank, president of the local Board of Trade, and a director of the Consigliman National Bank. He also served on the Hopkinton Board of Selectmen. He was born in Hopkinton March 10, 1851. He was an only son, never married. He died at a young age of 54 in September of 1905. To the town of Hopkinton in his will, he left two $1,000 trusts and one $1,000 bequest. One trust was to the upkeep of the Valentine Tomb Cemeteries on the south side of East Main Street, just down the street. The other trust was for the care of the grounds of the Hopkinton Common. The bequest, also for $1,000, was to be used for the erection of a fountain that would be dedicated to memory of his parents. We met, did our research, sent out our RFQ, received several bids, reviewed them closely, and awarded the job to Jeff Picaccio, Sculpting Studios of Natick. After the winter snows melted enough to allow access to the fountain, it was disassembled, cleaned, repaired, missing pieces sculpted and cast, painted and reassembled, all along with a state-of-the-art pump. Sounds kind of easy, but It took a team of skilled and dedicated craftsmen led by Jeff, working hard and long to get us what we have today. In closing, I'd like to thank Parks and Rec, my committee, CPC, the family of Paul Annunziata, town departments and officials, Sunnyside Gardens and the Girl Scouts, and of course, Jeff and his team for making this day possible.
Everybody, join me in singing to our town. Happy birthday.
On the Saturday following the ceremony, it was time for Hopkinton to celebrate as the middle school, high school back lot was filled with music, food trucks, and thousands of people who got to enjoy some great entertainment and perhaps one of the greatest fireworks shows around the area.
Many gathered outside the middle school and high school for Light Up the Night during the 300th anniversary celebration weekend. The night featured food trucks, live bands, games for the kids, Hopkinton trivia.
Question, where is he from? Who is the town of Hopkinton named after? Just come on up here and yell at my face. Edward Hopkins is right!
As well as the photo project, in which people wrote personal messages or Hopkinton-related messages on their body to be compiled into a 300-image and donated to the town for display for all community members to enjoy.
It's really starting to fill in at this point in the night here. In back of you, you've got 500 people waiting in line for food at the food court, and we got another probably a couple thousand down the football field. The band's been great. Everyone seems to be having a real good time. We've had all kinds of fun events so far today, and it's only going to get better here in another 90 minutes when we get the fireworks started after the Metro West Symphony Orchestra. But you're right. I mean, this has been 4 hours of great fun, backed up by 5 years of hard work to get here. And what's amazing about this, and I think most people don't know, is that there's been two groups now working on this almost for 5 years. We started a 300th committee run by Jean Birchman about 4 years ago now, actually, and she's been working on this since before that. And then there's also a group called the Friends of the 300. That's a private net group that came together almost 5 years ago. And they are the ones who put together the parade for tomorrow. So this weekend is the culmination of thousands of hours of work by hundreds of hours of volunteers just to get here. And now we've still got hundreds of people walking around in orange shirts who are helping everything run efficiently, who are taking pictures in the photo booth downstairs, who are helping the bands get set up. Just walking around and sort of helping people with things. So this is just a phenomenal community-wide event that has really been the product of literally hundreds, if not thousands, of people to get to this point. And couldn't be prouder. What a great way to celebrate our 300th birthday.
You know, it's a wonderful night out to celebrate with community, and it's really important to do that. 300 years is such a long time. And when you think about what's happened in the last 300 years, the amount of change not only here in this community, but in our country, and the role that residents right here in Hopkinton have played in that is something certainly worth celebrating.
The night ended with the Metro West Symphony Orchestra, followed by an unbelievable firework display. A look at the tremendous firework finale that topped off a night that will not soon be forgotten in Hopkinton.
After a tremendous fireworks display, the following day was an unforgettable parade to celebrate Hopkinton's 300th birthday, which featured many local and national bands, as well as entertainment.
Thank you.
That will wrap up this edition of HCAM News Focus. Congratulations on a tremendous job to the 300th Anniversary Committee and all who made the unforgettable celebration weekend possible. Don't forget, for those of you that missed the big 300th anniversary celebration weekend just a couple weeks ago, you can find hundreds of pictures of the tremendous weekend at sceneinhopkinton.org. You can also find many videos of all the tremendous events that took place on our website, hcam.tv. For everyone here at HCAM, I'm Tom Nappe. Thank you for joining us. Take care. And happy 300th birthday, Hopkinton.